Viewers like you make this program possible. Support your local PBS station.
You come to Vegas. Wow. We're in the middle of the desert. The strip is there. The kebab strip. The food is absolutely amazing. This is secret sauce. How come you didn't teach me? It's a city that constantly is growing, and then you have this Chinatown building and expanding just as much.
Now more than ever, people are willing to leave the strip.
We have a traditional Taiwan food.
Mongolian hot pot.
Taiwanese chicken.
Tempu noodles.
Tempu noodles, nice. Your food is so good. It's unfair.
This one's from Sichuan province, spicy.
Why do you think that Chinese food perception has to be cheap? It's by far the biggest cuisine in the world.
Okay, perfect.
People think of Chinese cuisine as fast food. It's something that we want to change to showcase that Chinese food doesn't always have to be the cheaper sibling in Asian cuisine.
This Chinatown would not exist without entrepreneurship and dreaming.
I'll gamble on anything. Yeah.
Okay, let's go.
There we go.
I need water or a beer.
Definitely you need a beer.
I'm Chef Marcus Samuelsson, and as an immigrant born in Ethiopia and raised in Sweden, food to me has always told a deeper, more personal story. It's a path to culture, identity, and history. Join me on a new journey across the country to learn more about America's immigrant communities and culinary traditions to see how food connects us all. If you only associate Vegas with nightlife, gambling, Frank Sinatra, and Elvis, you might not realize it's also extremely layered diversity. Now, for the last 20 years or so, it's become a destination for chefs. Some of the best restaurants in the entire world are actually now in Las Vegas. And every single major casino and hotel always has an incredible Chinese restaurant. One, because we get a lot of tourists from China, and Asian Americans have been the largest growing population in the state of Nevada for the last two decades. I've cooked in Vegas so many times, but I'm excited about getting to learn all about Chinese cuisine. Can't wait to dive into it. So I'm going to the Palazzo to check out this really chic restaurant called Mod 32. Very upscale, beautiful design that only Vegas can create. I mean, that kitchen is like a dream. What's up, Chef?
Hey, how are you?
How are you?
Good, good.
Thank you for having me. I'm meeting Chef Alan G, and he's a master in Chinese cooking. So when you call out the order, do you call them out in Mandarin, or do you call them out in
Cantonese?
Cantonese?
Yeah, Cantonese, Mandarin, and a little bit of English.
Perfect. So how do you say pick up?
Luo zao.
Luo zao.
Luo is a take, yeah. Zao is a wait.
Yeah.
Luo zao.
Luo zao.
Yes.
How do you say faster?
Fai di.
Fai di.
Yeah.
Table 32 ready. Fai
di. Yeah, fai di, fai di.
Well, show me the line. Show me what we're going to do. I'm excited.
I can make a mapo tofu for
I'm
you.
I'm here. I'm here. Okay. Feed me, Chef. Feed me,
let's,
Chef.
Let's do it. So let's clean the wok.
You know what I think is amazing, Chef?
Mm-hmm.
A wok that has been around for thousands of years. You can't improve it. This is the same wok that somebody created about 1,500 years ago. It's quick.
Yeah.
It's super hot.
When a chef have no hair, they always burn it. We use a lat to turn
the knee.
The knee, like a...
Like the twist.
Like that. Yeah. So
twist.
Turn on.
Save
you.
Whoa. Like that. 1,000 times a night, right?
Put some dark soy sauce.
Dark soy sauce.
Yeah. Reason why I put a dark soy sauce,
yeah.
Make the color.
Yeah.
Chili, oil. Okay. Ready to go.
Wow. The smell of this is amazing.
Yeah. It's not finished yet. If
you... No, I'm just smelling, Chef. So it's blanched lobster, and then you're finishing off in the stir fry.
Yes.
Watching Alan in the kitchen was absolutely amazing. It's like watching a dancer. And it's also the economy of the movement, right? Because it's hot and he's got to know what the next step is. He's so quick and precise in his movement.
We put the lobster like that. Lobster mapo tofu. Mix a little bit, flavor.
It's so delicious. The heat and the tofu for soft, and then the lobster on top. Yeah, I'm keeping this. It's a really theatrical vibe to Mod 32. They have an open kitchen, they have a big bar, incredible decor and design. But for me, the heart of the restaurant is really this incredible Peking duck oven, where they then bring out the duck and carve it tableside.
Oh, yes! I'm in heaven.
Peking duck has traditions that reaches back for hundreds and hundreds of years when it was a dish coming out of the Ming Dynasty.
First part, the skin.
So this is truly a regal dish.
Dip with brown sugar.
Hoisin sauce with sesame and peanut.
Oh, nice. Beautiful.
Just use your hands and pick the cucumber, scallion.
This must be one of the most popular dishes on the menu.
Yes, it is.
So we have limited availability of these. Mm-hmm. We only serve about 28 for each dinner service.
Yeah, that's the most important thing. We have the only restaurant with a Peking duck direct from oven to the customer.
It's a perfect dish. We have everything.
Great.
Crisp, flavor.
Juicy. Yeah. We have a lot of Chinese tourists here.
Yeah.
They like traditional Chinese food. So we try to introduce different regions from west to east, north to south.
Yeah.
Before, everybody think Chinese food is like cheaper. That's it. That's why we need bring the high-level Chinese food to the world.
When you come into this environment, there's no doubt. You step your foot here for 1 second, you're part of an experience. And when you have this duck, it's absolutely amazing.
In 1848-49, the Chinese were interested in coming to California and Nevada in pursuit of gold. They heard the rumors of gold and how you could be immediately wealthy. In the 1860s, it was decided that the West needed a transcontinental railroad. And so the Central Pacific said, if the Chinese can build the Great Wall of China, they can help us build this railroad. And they started with a small group, grew to 50, then 100, then 1,000, and eventually we estimate anywhere between 11,000 and 15,000 Chinese workers on the Central Pacific. In every major community that they went through, they would have a Chinatown built right near the railroad tracks because the Central Pacific would lease the land to them and they could build their Chinatown. The Chinatowns generally had restaurants, so there was an introduction of Chinese food from the railroad workers to the local population, and particularly after 1900, it was very fashionable to, quote unquote, eat Chinese food.
I can't imagine a neighborhood anywhere in this country, big city or small city, that doesn't have that staple Chinese-American restaurant. And this, for me, is pretty amazing. They're not owned by the same people, but yet, we expect the same thing. It should be fast, shouldn't be that expensive. It should taste exactly the way my Chinese restaurant in my neighborhood does. How is that even possible? I'm heading off the strip, so I got all of these big towers of hotels behind me. We're gonna focus on the local vibe. I'm meeting Jim, who really grew up in a restaurant family.
Hey, man, how are you?
Hey.
Nice to meet you. You good?
I'm great.
Good. I'm excited. You ready for some lunch?
I am ready for some lunch.
Cool.
Let's do it.
We're going to have one of the most iconic American meal you can think about, that basic Cantonese Chinese restaurant.
KJ Kitchen, this is like an old school Chinese Cantonese style food right here.
It's a great place to kind of like set a reference on. This is Chinese American food as we know it.
Wow, they got the live lobster and everything.
Oh, yeah. Do you like the shrimp with the heads on them?
Yeah, head on, absolutely.
My parents worked at a lot of Chinese restaurants when they first came over here,
and eventually ended up starting their own.
So you grew up in the industry, basically.
I grew up putting dishes away when I was little and eventually progressing like a prep cook to actually cooking. It was called the Hong Kong Restaurant in Idaho Falls, Idaho. Very small town, I think like 30,000 was the population.
Yeah, but with one good Chinese joint.
Yeah,
exactly. So you were born in China.
Born in China. Yeah. My sister and I were born in China. We came over as, I think I was 1 year old, so.
Oh.
My hometown, Taishan, which is actually, I'm proud to say, it was known as the home for overseas Chinese, because there's more people living abroad than actually in Taishan.
Taishan is in the Guangdong or the Canton province. Up until 1965, it's actually where more than half of all Chinese immigrants in America came from. Chefs came to this country with their know-how and their well-established hospitality culture. And very early on, they opened restaurants. Over time, Chinese-American cuisine started to take shape, either adjusting recipes to fit non-Chinese guests or using local ingredients in place what they would traditionally would have used in China. So these are some of the reasons why Cantonese food have become that classic Chinese-American cuisine.
Thank you.
Enjoy it.
Thank you.
What do we got? This is beautiful.
This is a Yang Chow fried rice. There's always gonna be eggs, onions, maybe barbecue pork, and they threw some shrimp in here. It's kind of like the typical basic fried rice that everyone's kind of used to. The XO sauce with the string beans, very popular. I mean, XO sauce is just grinded up seafood with some spice to it. Yeah.
There's so many gifts that we have in American cooking because of Chinese culture.
Uh-huh.
And I would put XO right up there with ketchup, right? Like, XO is everything.
You put XO on anything. Yeah. What do you like so far out of these dishes?
You know what I like is that it's comfort. I know what those beans are gonna taste like.
Right, right.
I know the pop,
right.
I know the little heat. This fried rice for me is just as comfortable as having a taco or having a burger.
This clay pot, it's a sea bass braised, the tofu in it, seeps in all that flavor, right? I really like this one a lot.
And that is kind of more the style that in your family with Cantonese culture you grew up with.
Nice. Exactly.
What would be your second favorite regional Chinese food, would you say?
Oh, I mean, it would be Sichuan food.
You like to sweat. You like, okay,
like sweat
it out.
In college, I actually did a studies abroad in Chengdu.
Oh, cool.
Yeah. The very first day I got there, I was sweating, and I asked them, can I have it not spicy, please? And they're like, that's your mild.
I bet you never felt as American as that.
Yeah
exactly.
Like, I tell my younger relatives and younger Chinese people all the time, too, I'm like, you don't know how good you have it. Because when I was growing up, you couldn't just go out and eat all these different types of Chinese food. It was, everything was considered weird. If you served a chicken with a head on it still, as a Chinese American, I'm getting to try these new dishes along with everyone else, too, right?
Mm. So you've been reintroduced to the authentic style of regional Chinese cooking.
Exactly.
Wow.
China is a huge country. 1.4 billion people in China. But now, because of traveling, trading, and also because of social media and internet, we want to learn what's Mongolian food like, what's southern China like, what's the difference between Sichuan cuisine and food from Shanghai. All of this different cuisine is going to come alive, and it's super interesting. I'm excited about it.
Because every Chinese cuisine and Chinese cuisine has a difference in the Chinese cuisine's taste is more spicy, sweet, and sour, all in there. It's a little bit more spicy. Garlic, garlic powder, we cook our own garlic powder. And we cook our own red oil. This is red onion. This dish is spicy, seasoning. We were in the 10th of June in Vegas, this city. For the past 3 years, we've been from small, now we've been slowly, Vegas, the local residents, 接受，无论是华人还是咱们的美国朋友，OK， 那大家可以尝一下啊，尝一下。What's up, chef? How are you?
Hi, how are you?
Where in China are you from?
Shanghai.
Shanghai. When did you come to Vegas?
About 8 years ago.
Straight from China or somewhere else in America?
From California.
So you're a California boy?
Yeah.
That's awesome. And what was the food like in Shanghai for you growing up?
Sweet.
Sweet.
And sour.
And sour. That balance back and forth.
Yes.
American sweet and sour has one of the most iconic American vegetables, ketchup, in it sometimes. In China, sweet and sour is much more subtle. It's really cooked in, integrated fully into the sauce and the recipe.
How do I know how much sour, how much sweet?
Usually one by one. So you put the same quantity of the sugars and the same vinegar. It's different with the American style of Chinese food because we're using the sugar to make the color instead of the food color, and we're using the black vinegar instead of the regular white vinegar. Mm. So it's my hometown favorite.
And you can do this dish with fish, pork, vegetables?
Vegetables, usually not.
Tofu.
Yeah, the tofu, yes. Yeah. Basically, see the color change?
Yeah, beautiful. It's almost like crackling the flour and the cornstarch is really working well.
So right now we're gonna do color. We're using the sugar for the color. Later we put the same amount of vinegar.
And this is the key one, because if you do it too much, it's gonna get burnt.
Yeah, once it's color changed, you have to stop right away and put up the vinegar, soy sauce. Otherwise it's overcooked, then it tastes bitter. Very nice. Okay, vinegar now. And you have to do it fast. Okay, perfect. At that time, we're gonna put a little bit of soy sauce. Okay, and we put the chickens inside. Very good. Excellent.
Wow, it smells so good.
And you will taste the different sour because we're using the black vinegars.
Yeah.
It's Shanghainese vinegars, Shanghainese flavors.
Guys, I love it. We're gonna garnish.
Yeah.
Nice, a little parsley. Beautiful. So sticky, so good. It's nice. It's very
nice. The sweet and sour is very balanced. Mm. Yeah.
I should go gambling right now. I'm lucky day.
No, it's called skills.
So in 1905, the railroad came to Las Vegas and opened Las Vegas as a train town. Right away, the Chinese came. The first Chinatown in Las Vegas was in the 1930s on Fremont and First Street. They had restaurants, grocery stores, later on, gambling casinos. The Chinese, of course, have a history of being interested in gaming. In the 1970s, the major casino owners started to attract Chinese tourists, especially during Chinese New Year's. Caesar's Palace was one of the first to really put an all-out event. And I still remember the first Chinese New Year's dinner. When they served rice, they served Uncle Ben's instant white rice. And eventually, in the 1990s, another Chinatown opened on Spring Mountain Road. And that then blossomed into the major Chinatown here in Las Vegas today.
Many cities in America, Chinatowns were really set up because there were so many discriminatory laws against the Chinese population. It was just not a choice where the community wanted to stick together. It was actually forced upon the community as well. Las Vegas were different in that sense. It didn't have those restrictions, so people could live anywhere. So I'm heading 5 minutes west of the Strip to about a 3 mile section on Spring Mountain Road. And the anchor point is Chinatown Plaza. So it's both a commercial destination and a culture destination. Hey.
Hi.
How are you?
Good, how are you?
Good to see you.
You too.
This is cool.
This is it, this is Chinatown. This was the first building that started this whole area.
Crystal is an amazing musician. She works 5 nights a week on the Strip. She is born and raised here in Vegas, and she was about 11 when Chinatown Plaza was built. So she used to come here to drink boba tea and hang out with her friends. Thank you.
Thank you. Got it.
Nice, nice.
boba green drink all over Southeast Asia, right?
Yeah.
So it has this texture of tapioca pearls. Very flavorful.
Yeah, it's kind of chewy.
Sweet and chewy.
Yeah.
How was it to grow up in Las Vegas? I mean, when someone said Vegas, right away people think about coming for a couple of days, partying, gambling. But a lot of people came to work because it was attractive. You know, you can get a job.
It's a lot like my parents. When they moved here, my dad was working in the casinos mm-hmm. as a
sure.
dealer.
Mm-hmm.
And their English wasn't perfect. Mm. They saw a lot of opportunities
yeah.
and opened their own business.
Oh, wow. So it's the mid-90s. This Chinatown Mall opens. It becomes a place for the community. I'm sure you were like running around here.
Yeah, there was an arcade here, and we'd come to the bookstore. This is where I discovered Chinese music, C-pop. I'd see all these CDs that I've never seen before.
It yeah.
was before the internet.
We all know about K-pop, but C-pop, do not sleep on it, right?
Exactly.
How did you get into being a musician?
Well, I started when I was 5.
Yeah.
And here I am.
Here you are, being a musician, playing on the strip. The strip provides gambling, sure, but a lot of people don't think about what an incredible sort of hub for creatives it is.
Yeah, for all the arts. There's always shows going on, musicals, productions, a lot mm. of opportunity here. So I'm gonna take you to TNT Ginseng. My mom will be there.
Oh, nice. What's up, Mom?
Hey.
How are you?
Nice meeting you.
Nice to meet you, Marcus.
Hey. My mom, Nina.
Nice. Hey.
This is a Chinese herb store. They sell all kinds of dry Chinese goods. They have ginseng.
Beautiful. There's so much Chinese medicinal that is so unknown to me,
yes.
but I know I need it. Tell me about the tradition of medicinal stores, like tea shops like this.
I think every Chinatown needs an herbal store like
yeah.
this. A lot of Western medication, a lot of people kind of stare away from.
Yeah.
So a lot of people turn to Chinese teas, Chinese herbal medication
yeah.
for the same conditions, mm-hmm. flu.
If Crystal come in, mm-hmm. she would ask, okay, I have this ache, I have this
yeah.
pain, and then she will go to the...
So you need an herbal doctor to write you a prescription.
Yeah.
And then she will fill it just like any other pharmacy.
Mm-hmm.
She'll make batches of the medication.
Yeah.
And then you boil it, mm. and then you will drink it.
Nice.
Yeah.
Thank you so much.
Yeah, no problem.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Vegas is really similar to LA in a way in terms of it has these unassuming strip malls, right? Mall after mall after mall. And each one of these plazas, there is amazing food happening. Nina and Crystal is taking me across the street from Chinatown Plaza to their absolutely favorite restaurant, Ji Mei Champion Taiwan Deli. China and Taiwan has a really complex political relationship, but we don't have to talk about that to enjoy this incredible, delicious food. Taiwan takes influences from mainland China, also Japan, that colonized Taiwan for many, many years. And then, of course, the indigenous population.
How are you?
How are you?
Good, I'm excited to be here.
Yeah.
The boss is here.
Yeah. Boss lady.
Oh, boss and boss lady, exactly.
In Taiwan, she's a movie star and World War II hero.
Yeah. Wow, that's yeah. amazing.
My mom is very good friends with Foreman, and she's
yeah.
here all the time. And
nice.
So they all party together.
Good.
So we have a traditional Taiwan food. In Chinese, we call it sao bing, you tiao, dou jiang. So let's have a traditional Chinese breakfast, a couple of stuff go out.
Whatever first. You like.
All right.
Whatever you like. Chinese breakfast basically turned out to be a banquet. Nice. I'm going to try a little bit of everything.
Okay.
So this is omelet
oyster.
With oyster?
Yes.
I love that.
Okay. And this one, it's a stinking tofu.
I love it. The hard part is pacing yourself. From the stinky tofu, how do you call it in Mandarin?
Pao cai.
To homemade soy milk, very good. With these like long stick, almost like churros looking donuts.
Because so many people order eggs and the Chinese donut, so I made a one, donut and Chinese pancake together.
The donut, you're killing it with the donut. The oyster omelette is really nice.
You like it, huh?
Uh-huh.
This one's our xiaolongbao soup dumpling.
Oh.
I say I want to do traditional Chinese Taiwanese food. Taiwan's a very good food place. Everybody go to Taiwan vacation, they want to eat Taiwan food,
yeah.
you know. It's the best.
The star dish at Taiwan Deli is its beef noodle soup. It's almost like a pho ramen broth. Handful of noodles, and then this hearty braised beef, and a ton of vegetables like bok choy, pickled mustard greens, scallions, super delicious.
Good.
This would be my favorite dish.
Nice. Chinese long life, long see it? Long life. Life.
The broth is fantastic, and then the bok choy and the noodle.
This is a special treat.
I have a young couple come. They from the San Francisco. He ate it, and he said, oh my gosh, this is the one when I was little in Taiwan. I never found this kind in the United States. And he said, do you deliver? I said, sure. So I went to the post office, and they will cost $150 for shipping. I said, okay, forget it. So I call him. I said, put your wife on the phone. He said, why? I said, I teach her how to make it. So I teach her.
That's so sweet. That's so sweet. Did you like it? Sign off from the boss? Good. Need signature from the boss. That's good. But this lunch was absolutely fantastic. Thank you so much.
I love my job.
Yes, I can tell.
Yeah.
I can tell.
United States is the best country. If you want to work hard, you get your opportunity, you know? But you need to work on it, you know? They don't come out from the sky, you know?
It doesn't?
No.
I thought when it
it doesn't.
You can you show me that place? I want to go to that place. Today, we celebrate Chinese cuisine, but it's really important to remember times wasn't always like that.
Anti-Chinese sentiment developed very early in the 1850s and 60s. There's this theory that when you see somebody who doesn't look like you or act like you, it's fear, and you want to keep them away. The movement grew stronger and stronger and motivated people to campaign on this issue. And so in 1882, Congress passed the Chinese Exclusion Act, which forbid the immigration of Chinese laborers. The only people who really could come over were merchants, merchant family, students, and diplomats. And then 1924, you have this great limit. Only 100 Chinese people could come in every year, no matter where they were living in the world. If you were Chinese, you fell under this quota of 100 per year.
These extremely restricted policies only ended when China became an ally to the US during World War II. But shortly after the turn of the 20th century, some restaurateurs were able to get a special visa that let them bring over new employees, mostly relatives, from China. So that is another reason why it became so many Chinese restaurants in America. Restaurants have really been a pillar of the community for so many years. So now I'm going to Chang Noodle Shop and meet Chef Sam to learn about hand-pulled noodles.
What's up, boss? How are you?
Good. How are you, Marcus?
Good to see you. What do you got there?
That's hand-pulled noodles.
Hand-pulled noodles. Nice.
Southern China is warmer and wet, and that's where rice is the main staple. Northern China is cooler and drier, and that's where wheat grows. So in Beijing, for example, the capital, that's where you find wheat-based noodles like this.
What, are you gonna teach me or what?
Of course, without deafening. Are you ready? So this first part of the process in Chinese is called liu mian. It's by spinning, crossing, that to get the dough really silken.
Yeah.
So we're gonna shake. You put up the two hands together.
Yeah.
Crossing.
Hold on.
And then we're gonna repeat
it
again.
Hold on.
Yes. There we go.
Did you grow up with this type of Chinese food, or is this something that you learned?
I didn't grow up with this because I live in southern of China.
Yeah.
But one time that I was traveling Beijing, I saw this hand-pulled noodles, and it was like, this is a piece of artwork.
And how do you go to the next step? How do you make them actually to the noodle part?
So this part is getting it to be silken.
Getting there, yeah.
And then we'll put it down on the tables. So we can see it's like pretty much same size. Uh-huh. And we're gonna spray a bunch of flowers on there to avoid it sticky as well. And from this part, we're gonna roll it. Are you ready to take a shot?
Yeah, let's do it.
So we're holding two sides of the dough. Shake it out. and come in like a U shape.
Yeah.
And then from this point, we're gonna keep doubling the dough so the noodles get smaller and smaller. So now we have four noodles.
Yeah.
More flour at the center point. And the hand will be just crossing the noodles.
Yeah.
Shake one time. Every two times, we're gonna rip it off. And we start from the center point again, and then that cross at the center of the dough, and we shake. Look how many noodles we get already.
Yeah.
When you go into places like Sam's Noodle Shop, it's like kids, families, it's everybody. It gives me these flashbacks as a kid going into the pizza shop where the pizzaiola was whirling, putting in the oven. It's the same thing when you go into the noodle shop. When I'm looking at these 8-year-old, 9-year-old kids eating fresh noodles, I bet you pulled noodles can definitely become the next wave of comfort food.
So this noodle, it's called Night Shape. We can stand really far, and you can still go into the park. Or you can get really close.
Yeah, yeah. That's awesome.
It's a flat noodle.
What I love is I've cooked all my life. I've never done this. There's always new ways you can learn in cooking.
Yes.
Always new tradition.
Yes, you're getting there.
Yeah.
Come on. Luis, better than you.
So basically, they can come up now, right?
Yes, you will love these noodles.
Yeah.
This one's stir-fried with ground pork with preserved veggie.
Uh-huh.
3 spoons will be good.
Yeah.
Otherwise, it's gonna be really salty.
Yeah.
And we have chili sauce with a soy sauce base.
Yeah.
And we're gonna add some chili oil.
Yeah. And what region of China would you say this is from?
This one's from Sichuan province, spicy.
So I get all the pork and the...
You got all the pork, you
chili
got the
oil,
sauce over there,
everything.
Chili oil.
Yeah.
No, and also with the texture of the noodles.
Mmm. Wow. Yeah. The numbness.
The numbness you're gonna get later after, you're gonna need a cup of ice water to cool it down.
Mm.
With a good amount of veggie and the pork, it just makes up a perfect balance of the noodles.
Nice.
Thank you, Marcus.
My man. I need water or a beer.
Definitely you need a beer.
Woo!
Las Vegas was hit pretty hard during the recession 2008, but it's bouncing back, and you can see it. There's more building coming up, there's more communities being built, so there's lots of opportunities here. And I'm gonna meet a young entrepreneur, Leo, that started this amazing tea business.
This is all about tea here.
Yes,
right?
100% just a tea house.
Tell me about how tea fits in every Chinese culture.
First of all, they don't drink ice water ever. I don't care if it's like 130 degrees in Vegas. I have family visiting from China.
Yeah.
All they want, hot water.
Hot water, I love it.
This is actually, we call it Taiping Hokui.
Yeah. Ooh, this smells beautiful.
This is a special Chinese green tea that is pressed after they pick it. So with the green tea, temperature matters. A lot of places actually that use boiling water to brew their green tea, which is a lot of times a problem. So we're gonna wait for it to cool it down a little bit.
Yeah, so it opens up the tea at the right temperature, right?
Yes, all the other one is the opposites. Mm-hmm. You want it high temperature to bring out all the flavor, but not green tea, it's gonna be bitter. Green tea, people always associate with Japanese green tea.
Yeah.
And then if they go to Chinese restaurant, they'll give you green tea, but it doesn't even look like the green tea that most people are familiar with.
Yeah.
In Japan, they took their tea from China a long time ago, and then they make their own style.
So a little bit brighter color than we normally used to with green tea, right?
Yep.
So the nose is beautiful, very sweet nose, right?
Yep. It's very heavy.
Very, very good. I'm ready, I wanna try the next one.
The second tea is my favorite. This one is Puer. It's an aged tea.
Wait. You break it up?
Yeah, you have to break it up. This is, we call it a cake.
Oh.
Yeah. A lot of people doesn't know that all of this come from Camellia sinensis, right?
Mm.
They all come from the same leaf. Green tea is not processed, and then black tea is completely oxidized. This comes from an area that is very hard to reach. It's government protected, and the tree has been around for hundreds of years, and they literally have to climb to pick the leaf. One day is this, you can brew this 15 to 20 times.
Wow.
So one little thing like that, we can drink this for like 2 hours.
I just love the flavor of that. A little bit heavier, very complex, almost like a Pinot Noir, like a very complex the way it's built in structure.
Uh-huh.
Feels really rich and luxurious.
The tea has an element that is good for your brain, and so it makes you focus more. So you're actually going to have a smart conversation over a cup of tea.
I thought bourbon was the way to get a smart conversation. All these years, that's clearly wrong.
Yeah.
But this is beautiful, and it's such a fun way to be educated about something. It's also very social. I want to know, and I want to engage.
We are living in an area where everybody kind of just like going to, I don't know, bars and nightclub, and people are getting more and more lonely in a way because it's getting harder to socialize now.
Yeah.
The kind of people that come here, they come in the beginning because they love the tea.
Yeah.
But what I realized later on, they actually care about like helping each other. Our customer were able to make the tea for each other, for some stranger that you never met.
Wow, nice.
And we all going to share the same cup of tea.
Yeah. It's culture.
It's culture, it's social feel about it. It's an amazing community you want to be in with. It almost feels like it's not my shop anymore.
Wow, that's great. Then you really succeeded.
Now when I'm a little tea drunk, which is a thing, by the way, I'm heading back to the plaza right next door to Chinatown Plaza, and I'm going to meet Alan. And he owns this place that was started by his dad. It's one of the oldest restaurants in the Chinese community in Vegas.
Kung Fu Thai and Chinese restaurant. Where's Bruce Lee? Where's the Kung Fu stuff?
Back then it was cool. Now people think that we're teaching Kung Fu instead of cooking.
So we're here to do a duck dish. Tell me the duck dish we're gonna do.
The duck dish is an ancient recipe. It's called Daeju roast duck. It predates Peking duck.
It's older than Peking duck?
It's older than Peking duck.
Wow. But it's younger than me.
Yeah.
I see a lot of different good ingredients. This is just to marinate it?
This is both marinated and to make the gravy.
So this is cinnamon, star anise, and galanga?
Dry galanga.
Also very Thai.
Yep. Sweet soy sauce and black soy sauce.
Mm. Oyster sauce?
Mm-hmm. And five spice blend.
Five spice blend.
Yeah.
This is the stuff. Cilantro.
Oh, you know how to do it.
Oh, it smells good. This is a good-sized duck, huh?
Yes. Uh-oh. We use the same duck as they use for Peking. There's more meat around the rib area. So whenever we cook, we use six duck at a time. So it stays upright.
I love that. That's really smart.
Yeah.
And how long do we simmer it?
1.5 hours.
This duck, though, is not cured. We didn't dry it, the skin, or anything like that, right? So it's just great duck simmering in this wonderful stock for 1.5 hours.
Daeju roast duck.
Yes.
Daeju is a Chinese dialect. Our family came from Santao, north of Hong Kong, in Guangdong province.
And how did you get to Thailand?
During the Civil War in the 30s, where the communists and the capitalists were fighting each other, a lot of Chinese saw that the capitalists was gonna lose, so they all migrated down south. Most of the people either went to Indonesia, Philippines, Vietnam, Cambodia, our family settled in Thailand.
So, in the restaurant industry, your family is really pioneers, right? Opening in downtown Vegas.
Yes. They first started on 3rd Street in Fremont, because back then, that's where all the action was. And then from 82 to 93, we were the first independently operating restaurant in a major hotel casino.
Wow.
We basically started the trend. After we moved here, literally about a year later, Chinatown started.
Was it always Chinese Thai restaurant?
When we first started, our menu consisted of 3/4 Chinese food and 1/4 Thai food. Because back in the early 70s, there was only 2 other Thai restaurants in the whole United States.
Wow.
So no one knew what Thai food was.
Thai food was.
Yeah.
And today it's probably one of the most popular cuisines that we have.
Nice. This duck is the opposite from a Peking duck, where it's all about the crispy skin. Here it's actually all about these subtle flavors that come from the broth.
Oh, here's the good stuff.
It has this super flavorful meat that comes through the marinade and the slow simmering, but really delicious.
Good, looks so beautiful. It smells unbelievable.
Marcus, this is my wife, Jill.
How are you, Jill?
This is Marcus. So in Thailand, the Thais will eat this with the hot sauce.
It's beautiful. It's sour and spicy.
Mm-hmm.
This is secret sauce. How come you didn't teach me?
homemade hot sauce.
Gil, you're gonna give me the recipe for this, Gil. So, Gil, are you also Thai Chinese?
Thai Chinese, yes.
You both. Your food is so good. It's unfair. You have the best of both worlds. Like, you have Chinese and you have Thai. It's very unfair. But the duck, that's an art and that's an ancient tradition. If you don't cook this, maybe this recipe one day will go away.
Yeah, I think about all the hundreds of years it took my ancestors to, you know, to keep on making this. And how blessed I am to still have the recipe to make it. Because you can't find this anywhere. It's getting to be an endangered dish, so to speak.
I cannot give any advice. You've been in business 40 years, you know what you're doing. You're already very successful. So right now, I'm gonna check out this fun destination dining spot called Chubby Cattle. Hot pot is a dish that you find all over China and many places around Asia. And today, I'm learning about traditional Mongolian hot pot. Mongolia is on China's north border. It's a cold place. It has long winters, so it makes complete sense that they are experts in hot pot.
How is that?
Broth is fantastic. The base of it is amazing.
Yeah, missing the Mongolian herbal.
Exactly.
This is the hongzhao. It's good for your blood.
Yeah.
This is dragon eye. Tastes a little bit sweet.
Almost like a dried prune or an apricot.
Yes.
Yeah. Nice.
This is a gochi. It's make the soup taste sweeter too. And now green onion, ginger, garlic.
So hot pot gets started in the kitchen, but gets finished at the table. I'm sitting down to eat with Chef Harvey and his two business partners. These guys are young entrepreneurs, and they're taking these ancient dishes and put it into this super fun and modern environment. Tell me about Chubby Cattle. Who came up with the name?
So this came about 2.5 years ago when Harvey and I met, and then we met Joyce. Three of us came up with the name together.
Yeah.
Fat Cattle.
Yeah.
Fat
Cattle. That's a good one, too.
Fat Cow.
Yeah.
Everything's about the beef.
The beef,
because Harvey wanted to focus on the quality beef for the hot pot.
So how are we going to eat this? I want to eat.
You cook in a family pot, shabu-shabu style. You put the beef in for like 3 to 5 seconds, and it's ready to go. Hot pot is the number one cuisine in China. Everyone on the weekend want to go to hot pot, whether friends go out or you go on a date. You're cooking together, you're feeding each other. I think that's a big part of it.
And it makes it fun and something to talk about.
You can see the refrigerator conveyor belt over here. Mm-hmm. All the small portions food you can just grab yourself.
We also have dipping sauces, and you can customize your own ingredients. You have all types of different cultures coming to our restaurant. It's kind of like sushi, right? Everyone's eating sushi and Japanese food, and we want to get to that point with hot pot as well.
Is either one of you born in Mongolia?
Me.
Nice.
I grew up in a highly competitor hot pot area.
Yeah. What's the biggest difference between working in America and working in Mongolia?
Mongolian people prefer eating pure herbal soup.
Oh.
But American people prefer chicken soup. That's why I combined chicken soup with herbal soup.
Well, I love the broth. All the aromatics that you added, the sweeter notes, almost like this mellow nutmeg flavor. And I like the little fat that comes on top from the wagyu and everything. It's very nice.
We all had a dream about revolutionizing Chinese cuisine, because when it came to the U.S., people think of Chinese cuisine as something fast food, you know, you got your orange chicken, chicken broccoli, and so we really wanted to show, even at affordable rate, you can have premium ingredients, really showcase the history of our culture.
Chinese food in America has obviously evolved, but it's also, I think, so important to look at all the hard work the Chinese American immigrants did. People stuck together, fought through really tough laws that were up against them, providing jobs for generations and generations.
Absolutely.
So you have a lot of tradition there.
Yeah.
But you bring in a whole new other connectivity because you're younger, you work with technology. What do you see? Like, what can people like yourself do in this generation?
There's a lot of misconceptions about what a country is based on their politics. And I think we have to look past that and look at, you know, the people in itself. What are they eating? What are they listening to? Food and music and entertainment, these are all platforms for people to get closer in a global way, right? I think that's key.
Nice, that's awesome. Whether it's through delicious food, art, or music, it's all about curiosity.
So right now, I've been invited to this community center to check out a Chinese music ensemble.
Is this your kid?
The director, Miss Lee, is trying to preserve Chinese culture in this super modern society in Vegas, teaching both kids and adults to play traditional instrument and music.
Good job, man. Hi, how are you? What's your name?
Good, Justin.
Justin. I love this instrument.
Thank you.
Wow.
At this culture center, there's a lot of things going on. It's just this beautiful mishmash of adults, kids, instruments, costume changes. And then on top of that, a spread of homemade food.
A lot of our parents are actually really good cooks. This is rice cake.
That one's from Shanghai.
From Shanghai?
Yes.
Here we have
more like a vegetarian, that one, soya bean and tofu.
And here?
Oh, that's a good one.
Wait. That's because she made it.
Yes. What do you like the most about coming?
It's pretty interesting because we're all Chinese in a sort. A lot of people come from Taiwan and not from China.
Yeah.
And if we do come from China, it's like a whole bunch of different regions. So even family like upbringing is a little different from like yours, even though you grew up here.
Yeah.
Your parents are both Chinese and brought up in China. So it's we're all still have our different traditions.
Yeah,
all
so we're
our
still
different
learning from each other.
Family things, yeah.
So nice. Especially like after rehearsals and stuff, we eat together, talk about how our practice went.
I love it. Good job. Good job. I was really impressed to see the whole community coming together. And
我就是想把中国的文化介绍到美国。
And it's just Vegas in particular where there was seriously nothing here.
But it's young, you know. Chinatown in Vegas is young, so it makes sense that culture-wise, it takes a little while. Mm-hmm. Think about what Chinese food has done to America in terms of bringing non-Chinese culture together.
Right.
Music could be the same thing.
That's what our goal is, to spread as much as possible. Yeah.
Casino opened in 1963, and it's the only Chinese American owned casino in Nevada. The owner of Eureka approached us and said, "Hey, we have a kitchen. Please keep the chicken wings, hamburger, and Philly cheesesteaks, and you can do whatever you want with the menu."
It's kind of a fine balance of creativity versus foods that people can relate to. So, the bao, we tell people it's an Asian sandwich.
Is it yummy?
I think it allowed people to see, wow, there is actually an Asian American influence in downtown.
For us, this is where we live. This is where we raise our kid.
So we wanted to create this microcosm, this little local economy that we can support.
I always thought Vegas was kind of like the Wild West. Like if you have a vision, you make it happen.
If we're putting our heart into it, people will come.
So I've been all over Vegas, from the Strip to Chinatown. But downtown Vegas is really my happy place. Just look at all the signs. Casino so-and-so that's been around forever. El Cortez, all of these places. You feel like you're walking through a 50s or a 60s movie. Maybe Frank Sinatra and Sam and Dave is gonna come out of one of these places. And you just have this vintage vibe around it. I'm meeting up with Sheridan and Jenny at their second restaurant, Flock and Pop, which is a stone throw away from the original Chinatown in Vegas on Fremont and First. And we're gonna make one of my favorite dishes of all time that I've never been able to master, Hainan chicken. What's up, chef? How are you?
Hey, chef.
So what are we doing?
So we have some Hainanese chicken.
Yeah.
Hainan chicken started in southern China, a small island called Hainan. It's a very simple, humble dish, and really, for me, it's like the essence of chicken.
It is, right? And isn't it supposed to be served room temp, basically, or what?
Yes, it's poached chicken. We never serve it hot or cold, always room temperature.
Then you serve it with rice?
Yes, aromatics of ginger, garlic, scallions, all cut together with chicken fat, a little bit of pandan leaves.
So the key word here is chicken fat. That's really the key word, right?
That's the secret. So it's plated. We have three different sauces.
Yeah.
This one's the chili sauce, or our house-made soy.
Soy.
And our ginger sauce.
Nice.
Hey, Jenny, can you scoop a bowl of rice?
Yeah.
Oh, you can smell the aromatics.
Yes. We're gonna eat well.
Yeah. We thought we knew what Hainan chicken rice was.
Yeah.
And like 2013, 2014, we took a trip out to Taiwan, ate Hainan chicken, and it blew us away. We came back every day. He was obsessed about chicken and rice.
Before we opened Flock and Fowl, I tested this recipe pretty much every day for about 6 months. And
no choice.
Was, yeah.
I love it. All right. This looks good.
Hi, Chef.
I've had this dish before. I love it. I can't wait to try it.
It's solely a passion project. Yeah, and our goal was perfect rice, perfect chicken, and perfect
and
sauce.
Is. The chicken is amazing. You grew up in the restaurant industry, right?
Yes. My parents opened and closed 19 restaurants all
over. So the key word that
Los
is
Angeles.
Open and closed,
yes,
right?
Opened because we did and both. Closed. My mom and dad are from Canton and Hong Kong. Mm-hmm. My mom only had kindergarten, and that was it. And then she went off to work, and that pretty much was her life, like no education. My dad studied till like eighth grade, and he actually practice for like a whole year to swim from Canton to Hong Kong. The swim is 4 hours. And at first, you know, like, I always thought it was a joke. Oh, swimming to Hong Kong. But it's true. They swam to Hong Kong to escape communism.
Unbelievable.
It's unbelievable. So anyway, in 1978, they come to America. In 1979, his mom also came to LA, and we were actually both born at the same hospital.
No!
Yeah.
So my mom worked in restaurants as well. She was there 7 days a week. The kitchen kind of took me in, and that's how it started for me.
Downtown Vegas, obviously been around for a long time, but yet it feels new. What's happening here?
I would say in the last few years, there's been a lot of new development. We want to help build our community and add culture, some good food,
sure.
and a place for people to hang out.
I think for us, we were both so scared to say that we want to be in restaurants.
Yes.
It's true and authentic to who we are. We are Chinese Americans that experience the labor of our parents coming in for a first generation of refuge. They found it, then they went for the dream. I just feel like we got the choice to do what we wanted, and we still chose restaurants. Yeah.
So I love to see something that is rooted in tradition, but yet you're doing it your own way.
That's
really cool. So
maybe we'll start our own little Chinatown. It's gonna take tons of years, but it would be great if we could do something like that.
Couple of things about my Vegas trip. Yes, I gambled. Yes, I lost money. But besides that, I ate so well. How do you say cheers in Mongolia?
Ganbei.
From ancient recipes to modern presentation, it was really fun to explore all the diversity of the Chinese American culture here in Vegas.
Yes!
From strip mall to strip mall to strip mall, to see this all in Vegas, it's pretty amazing, and that speaks to the work ethic and the incredible ingenuity in the Chinese American community. I'll see you over at the Gold Coast. Come and save me. Just grab me.
I got you.
Unfortunately.